I think this is the high time that Egypt starts pursuing this file with the United States, with Europe, with the Security Council, United Nations, that, for example, a country like Turkey, which is hosting TV stations, or some of the other countries which are hosting TV stations, which are giving terrorist threats and giving support to terrorist activities in Egypt, that this station, they're either shut down, all these countries should be announced as hosts and safe havens for terrorists. Mm-hmm. So I think we need to start an orchestrated work internationally in diplomacy to try to use these current events to show the truth and drop all these masks that the Muslim Brotherhood have been using.
Yes. Well, Dr. Kharaj, do you think that with the latest developments and the attacks taking place in Sinai, along with Sheikh Nasrallah, who passed away, was killed during a protest downtown Cairo, do you feel that now Egypt's bid to actually have a non-permanent seat in the UN Security Council, do you see it as a possibility? Do you see the international community not really backing Egypt having a non-permanent seat? Where do you think Egypt's stance are regarding this one?
The killing of Sheikh Nasrallah is a very dark point in the security in the police forces history in Egypt. They either are involved in the actual act, or at least soldier and officer or so is involved. Some of the top generals were threatening that anybody who goes will be shot, and this was published in the Masri Yom with a bold line. So this really shows that the police institution still needs reform, still needs radical change, and that they still think that there is a vendetta between them and peaceful protesters like our 40 or 50 friends from Tahrir al-Shaabi who went to put flowers in Tahrir Square. This is, they are either involved or they are negligent. Mm-hmm. If they say that somebody, I mean, we are talking Talat Harb Street, mm-hmm. for heaven's sake. I mean, somebody carrying a gun and shooting a lady in Talat Harb Street in Talat Harb Square, where everybody is there and this is the heart of Cairo, and you cannot catch him and come up with him, and you are, so this is a dark spot. Mm-hmm. However, what's happening in Sinai is trying to provide us with international support. The whole international community is with us against these terrorist attacks. Mr. Sisi's statements are encouraging. That he said that Sheikh Nasrallah is my daughter, and we will find the murderer. The Minister of Interior was sort of put in an awkward position in public and said, yes, if it is an officer or a soldier, we will present him to court. I am concerned that this will not happen in a satisfactory way, but if it happened and real officials and those who were behind this act were presented to justice, mm-hmm. then we will have the start of a real transitional justice process and maybe a hope of a real reform in the police force. Yes, indeed, terrorist attacks on the police, the martyrs from and the courageous officers from the police force that are giving their life against terrorists are making it difficult for us people who are calling for reform in the police to shout up loud. I mean, yes, of course, we have to support them. Yes, they need reform, we will have to state that, but we have to support them against terrorists. We don't have any other option. We cannot say both of them are bad. No, the police is our only a chance, but we will say, we will still raise the flag that it needs reform, and it will be reformed at due time. No, all in all, I still think that Egypt's chances to get a seat in the Security Council are very well.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Mawara, now, President Sisi said that there will a unified command, military command, will be created in Sinai, joining both North and South Sinai forces together to eliminate terrorism taking place in the peninsula. How effective do you think such a strategy will be, and why hasn't this been done before, even though there were a series of terrorist attacks taking place in Sinai before, killing dozens of military, civilian, and security personnel?
I think that now, especially with this upcoming economic conference in Sharm el-Sheikh and the state of dispersion that we have seen, and the coordination between the Muslim Brotherhood local here and the terrorist organizations and the terrorist extremists in Sinai, I think it makes sense now to consolidate these forces, because you know, the conference is supposed to take place in South Sinai in Sharm el-Sheikh, and the fear is that some of these elements will try to sneak in using the very high terrains of the many valleys of Sinai, which to try to sneak in and cause some havoc, to try to kind of overshadow the economic conference, or maybe preempt it, have some strikes just before the conference to try to deter people from coming. So these are all risks that should be taken very seriously, and I think obviously that the Muslim Brotherhood view the coming parliament, completing the parliamentary elections plus this economic conference, as really a cornerstone to mark the end of the era, really. So I think that we can expect some really desperate measures. So it makes sense to consolidate these commands, and I really hope that Egypt would commit whatever necessary resources to try to end this evil, because even economic recovery or development projects in Sinai, all of these things, as we said, it requires a minimum level of security, it requires a control. Having some, you can never eliminate terrorist attacks altogether, but having some control, a level of control over a situation, I think, needs to be seen before we can see serious investment in Sinai or elsewhere.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Kharad, do you think that joining these forces, having this unified military command, do you think that this will take away a little bit from our the security of our borders?
No, I don't think so at all. I mean, this is just a strategy, another strategy, and no one can say if it is more effective or not. It's technical military decision, obviously a strategic military decision, if you like. So we may be changing strategies, trying a new strategy. This strategy may be more effective, less effective, but our main armed forces are still on the west bank of the Suez Canal. The number of forces, although increased with the consent of Israel, still a fraction of our main army, which is sitting by the Suez Canal in the back.
Yes. Well, Mr. Mawara, what about the police force, the security, the Ministry of Interior? Now, obviously, after the death of Shaima Sabah, they've been heavily under attack. Also, as Dr. Kharat mentioned, you see also their martyrs, and you have to support them in their fight against terrorism, and that leaves them in a very sensitive spot, sensitive situation. Do you feel that they are doing what they need to be doing? Do you think it's enough? Do you think that the media should go easy on them? Do you think that the media needs to toughen up against any shortcomings from the ministry? How do you assess the situation and this the position that the Ministry of Interior and their forces are being dealt with?
I think we need to take each package on its own. I don't think we should give a blanket on everything, either condemn or support. I think, of course, we need to support and cherish our soldiers, whether from the police or the military, who are protecting our security and who are fighting terrorists and capturing terrorists, whether here or in some other places. Mm-hmm. However, I think I agree with Dr. Kharad that what happened in the case of Shana, I think, is very disturbing, mm-hmm. because it's a very small number of protesters. They made it very clear that they were, in fact, peaceful and had this sort of symbolic flowers and so on.
They didn't even impact traffic. I mean, traffic was normal.
Just a very small number.
The pedestrians were walking around them.
I mean, so having Shana came in this way and with no explanation, with no even apology, we can acknowledge that mistakes happen, but the first reaction was, well, somebody else, it's not us, and you know, and start trying to pin it even on the leaders of the party or the political organization. I think the best thing that the Ministry of Interior is to learn from the lessons of the last 4 years. Mm-hmm. When the military stepped in 2011-2018, it was welcomed by the people because the military never had this kind of interaction, wrongful interaction with the people. But the police had a very bitter history. And I think in June 30th, 2013, the police was starting to be treated with that damage. Yes. And it was a tremendous opportunity. And I hope that our Ministry of Interior will really try to recapture the essence of that day and try to reverse these actions and in fact become more protective of demonstrators rather than harmful to them. Mm-hmm. And I think this way we can gain back the trust and the support, and which is very important at this point, of the Egyptian people.
Yes, definitely. Dr. Kharad, because we're running out of time, so in 30 seconds, tell me, what do you think of Egypt's demand actually of suspending these the TV channels being broadcast on the French satellite? Do you feel that this is a right move? Do you think Egypt will be granted this? How's the seriousness of this situation?
I think that even the hardest defender of the freedom of expression would recognize that this is a hatred discourse, that this is inciting violence, and these people are calling for violence and supporting terrorists, and therefore the Egyptian demand is fully justified.
Yes. Well, ladies and gentlemen, unfortunately, that's all the time we have for this edition of The Daily Debate. But before we go, I'd like to thank our very distinguished guest, Mr. Wael Nawara, the head of the political bureau of the Mohabbazin Party. I'd also like to thank Dr. Ehab Kharad, secretary of the Supreme Council of the Social Democratic Party. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, please stay tuned for more coming up on our international. I'm Hani Saif. Thank you for joining us.